Hi viewers, I take the pleasure of inviting you to this session wherein I am going to discuss with you a very important chapter of organic chemistry, namely alkyl halides. Alkyl halides is a rather big chapter. I may not be able to cover it in 2 to 3 modules. Therefore, I have decided to present to you only the glimpses of alkyl halides. So why alkyl halides is very important? Alkyl halides is rather significant because we can prepare almost all sorts of compounds using alkyl halides. We can prepare alkanes, alkenes, alkynes, alkyl benzenes, cyanides, alkyl cyanides, alkyl isocyanides, aldehydes, ketones, carboxylic acids, either directly or indirectly. A scientist by name Grignard has prepared a reagent RMGX using alkyl halides, won the Nobel Prize in the year 1912, with which one can prepare all sorts of compounds. What are alkyl halides? Alkyl halides are obtained by replacing a hydrogen of alkanes with a halogen atom. We know pretty well there are different halogens like fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, astatine. Astatine being radioactive, we don't know much chemistry of it, but all the remaining four elements, namely fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, they are of high use in alkyl halides chapter. Halogens being more electronegative compared to carbon, the carbon-halogen bond in alkyl halides is always more polar. As a result, there will be partial positive charge on carbon and partial negative charge on halogen atom. Because of this polarity of carbon-halogen bond, generally alkyl halides prefer to undergo nucleophilic substitution reactions besides elimination reactions. Let's go to the board to discuss these reactions in detail. In alkyl halides, the carbon halogen bond is a polar bond because of the electronegativity difference between carbon and halogen atom as shown here. So in all these cases, carbon has only 2.5 electronegativity units, whereas the halogen electronegativity decreases as we are moving from fluorine to iodine. However, even iodine has more electronegativity compared to carbon. Therefore, in alkyl halides, the halogen atom bears the partial negative charge and carbon atom bears the partial positive charge. As a result, the carbon halogen bond is more polar. These alkyl halides will prefer to undergo nucleophilic substitution reactions. Depending upon the carbon to which halogen atom is attached, alkyl halides are classified into three types. They are tertiary alkyl halides, because this is a 3 degree carbon. What do you mean by 3 degree carbon? 3 degree carbon is a carbon which is directly attached to 3 more carbons like this. So it's a tertiary alkyl halide. What about this? This is a secondary alkyl halide, because to a 2 degree carbon, a halogen atom is attached here. Now what is this? This is basically a 1 degree carbon to which halogen is attached. Therefore it is a primary alkyl halide. Now what about this one? Basically this is a methyl halide. After seeing the classification of alkyl halides into primary, secondary, tertiary, etc., then we may be getting a doubt whether all these alkyl halides adopt the same path during the substitution reactions, namely the nucleophilic substitution reactions. The answer for this is definitely not. Then what type of path that is chosen by alkyl halides during the nucleophilic substitution reactions? There are various types of nucleophilic substitution reactions depending upon the path of the mechanism. One is nucleophilic substitution unimolecular, SN1. The other one is SN2, nucleophilic substitution bimolecular. The other one is nucleophilic substitution intramolecular, SNI. However, there is SNAR also, which we normally see in aryl halides. Now, what are the aspects that we need to focus to select a particular alkyl halide for a particular mechanism? It is rather important that we need to focus on certain aspects, especially to decide the path of a mechanism by an alkyl halide. What are they? The first one is nature of alkyl halide taken. Generally, tertiary alkyl halides prefer SN1 mechanism. Primary alkyl halides prefer SN2 mechanism, whereas secondary alkyl halides may prefer SN1 or SN2 depending upon the other conditions. Then what are the other conditions that we need to focus? The other conditions are strength of the nucleophile. Generally, weak nucleophiles prefer SN1 path, whereas strong nucleophiles prefer SN2 path. Then what about the other factors on which this nucleophilic substitution depends? Nucleophilic substitution also depends upon the polarity of solvent. Generally, polar protic solvents prefer SN1 mechanism, whereas polar aprotic solvents prefer SN2 mechanism. And generally, because nucleophilic substitution reactions are exothermic in nature, the temperature of the medium should be kept low. Okay, let's go to the board to discuss each of these mechanisms in a detailed manner. Just now I told you that SN1 mechanism will be adopted by tertiary alkyl halides. So I am taking a tertiary butyl chloride here. Tertiary butyl chloride. So here carbon bears partial positive charge and chlorine bears partial negative charge like this. So what happens? Initially the carbon halogen bond gets ruptured on its own to produce a carbocation intermediate. We all know very well carbocation will be sp2 hybridized. As a result, the intermediate obtained here is flat, a trigonal plane shaped species with the elimination of Cl minus ion like this. This is the so called rate determining step or slowest step. In a chemical reaction, especially in a complex chemical reaction which proceeds in more than one step, then the slowest step determines the total molecularity of the process. In this particular slowest step, there is only one molecule of reactant present, namely the alkyl halide. Therefore, this particular reaction is also referred as unimolecular reaction. Definitely, it is a first order reaction because here rate is directly proportional to only the alkyl halide concentration, because the incoming nucleophile is not seen at all in the slowest step, namely rate determining step. Okay, now this particular electrophile or carbocation intermediate generated in the first step, namely step 1, may recombine with the chloride ion that is produced and gives you back the so-called alkyl halide. That may happen. Why that is not happening? A question may be asked. Why that's not happening? Because here we have taken a polar protic solvent, very, very important factor, polar protic solvent. Because the polar protic solvent is taken, this polar protic solvent will definitely stabilize the ion pair that is generated here. We have got a carbocation and also we have got an halide ion. So both of them will be definitely stabilized by the polar protic solvents. Then what are polar protic solvents? Polar protic solvents are water, acetic acid, alcohols, etc., ammonia, etc. What are polar protic solvents? Polar protic solvents are water, acetic acid, ammonia, alcohols, etc. Let us see how it stabilizes the leaving. Let us see how this stabilizes the chloride ion eliminated. We know very well if water is taken, because of the electronegativity difference, we have partial negative charge on oxygen and partial positive charge on hydrogen as shown here, and our chloride ion is here, and this is being attracted by the partial positive ends of water molecule like this. So we can have any number of structures like this. So in this way, the chloride ion is stabilized. As a result, the chloride ion will not combine with this carbocation intermediate to give you back the so-called substrate taken. Polar protic solvent not only stabilizes the chloride ion, but also stabilizes the carbocation. How does it stabilize? Because we have the oxygen ends of water molecule which are coming this way with the partial negative charge. So both the carbocation generated as well as the chloride ion obtained are stabilized by polar protic solvents. Therefore, for SN1 reaction, we need to have polar protic solvents. The other salient feature here is that the carbocation intermediate generated in step 1 is also stabilized due to hyperconjugation, due to inductive effect like this. We all know very well all methyl groups, namely all alkyl groups, are plus psi affecting in nature. As a result, they decrease the positive charge here, stabilizing this particular species. And here we are having 9 alpha hydrogens also. Therefore, we can write 9 no bond resonance or 9 hyperconjugative structures for this carbocation. Because the tertiary carbocation is more stabilized by hyperconjugation as well as resonance, generally tertiary alkyl halides prefer to undergo this particular nucleophilic substitution via SN1 mechanism. Okay, let's go to step 2 now. In step 2, the intermediate carbocation formed in the first step is attacked by the incoming nucleophile. This is a very fast step. So the incoming nucleophile, namely Nu minus, this can be OH minus, CN minus, etc. The incoming, even water molecule, it can attack this particular carbocation either from the front direction or from the back direction like this. Because this is a flat molecule, we can have front and back ends attack of the nucleophile. As a result, I am going to get the final product, namely CH3, 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 Nu, incoming nucleophile. This is a very fast tab. This is our product. In the SN1 mechanism of hydrolysis of tertiary butyl chloride, if we observe carefully, here a CCl bond is broken and a CO bond is formed. CO bond is formed, CCl bond is broken. But energy of CCl bond is less compared to energy of CO bond. Whenever a chemical bond is formed, energy will be released. Whenever a chemical bond is to be ruptured, energy is absorbed. Therefore, here released energy is more compared to absorbed energy. Hence, generally these SN1 reactions are exothermic in nature. Not only that, in these reactions, if we observe the energy profile diagram, because we are having more than one steps, we have a dip like this, which is indicating the intermediate state, and this indicates the reactant, and this is the product which is at lower energy compared to reactant, indicating that this reaction is exothermic. Here the delta H is negative. Fine. So what is this? This is reaction coordinate. What about this one? This is energy of activation, or it indicates energy axis. So here the carbocation intermediate is formed. What is the carbocation intermediate that we have seen in this particular case? It is a trimethyl carbocation, which is a triangular plate shaped species like this. What is the reactant taken here? It is nothing but a tertiary butyl chloride. I am going to write it here for clarity's sake. This is the one. And what is the final product obtained? The final product obtained here is a tertiary butyl alcohol. This one. This is the energy profile diagram of SN1 reaction. So one should be very, very careful to draw the energy profile diagram. Why? Because majority of you will not focus much on the shoulders. Mind you, this shoulder must be at lower height compared to this shoulder. Or else what happens? The intermediate carbocation that is generated here
instead of forming a product as shown here, may go back to form the reactant. Therefore, the height of this shoulder should be always lower compared to this. If this is the activation energy for the formation of the intermediate, and if this is the activation energy EA double dash for the formation of product from the intermediate, definitely EA dash must be greater than EA double dash. This is the condition one should not forget. Until now, we have seen the mechanism of SN1 reaction and also the energy profile diagram of SN1 reaction and the different reactions given by alkyl halides in this module. In our next module, we are going to cover the factors affecting SN1 reaction and also very important critical examples of SN1 reaction involving ring expansion, rearrangement and optical activity, etc.